Interesting. Right. You know, Ambassador, what do you make of the Pentagon report, really? Is the situation as dire as it you know, makes it out to be?
I think the Pentagon report, in a very crystal clear fashion, enunciates the fact that China's outreach, the global outreach, is growing at the expense of many other countries, including the United States and, of course, India. Now, you rightly talked about Cambodia. Along with Cambodia, the Chinese have also sought bases in Vanuatu. And I understand that both these countries, Cambodia and Vanuatu, have declined it. But at the same time, Cambodia, for instance, has accepted military assistance from China. And the Chinese have a policy of slowly implementing their designs. It's called the creep and acquire policy. They did it with great stealth in very masterly fashion in the South China Sea, where those islands, the Spratly Islands, were really under the control of Philippines and Indonesia and Brunei. And the Chinese really had no presence there, but then they acquired some reefs. They made their presence felt on some reefs. And slowly, before people could realize, they added 3,200 hectares of land by reclamation to these reefs. And now they have full-fledged bases there. So the Chinese strategy is to play with time and go very slowly and catch people unawares. So I worry that in our neighborhood, they are trying to do quite the same thing. Now, what should be India's approach? We should be very careful to distinguish between what we should not do and what we should do. For one thing, we should not be drawn into any military alliances against the Chinese, because the Chinese are very sensitive about this matter. Now, the Americans have floated this idea of the OBOR. The Quad.
Yeah.
And they have roped in India along with Japan and Australia as the four members for this. India has been opposing the idea of converting this into a military sort of configuration, because the Chinese are going to be upset. So we already have a difficult relationship with the Chinese, and we should not get embroiled in a worsening relationship.
Yeah, we shouldn't complicate matters.
We should not complicate matters. What we should do is to befriend our neighbors and other countries in the larger region, so that they are equally wary of what the Chinese presence entails. For instance, I spoke of the Spratly Islands. Now, Indonesia, Philippines, are greatly upset about the Chinese presence there and the Chinese setting up a base there. So we should engage in dialogue with these countries to sensitize them about what Chinese activities in that region are doing, which would be harmful for them.
Right.
So rather than trying to form a military alliance, we should, through very good and adroit diplomacy, sensitize all these countries. Of course, it is very important to have India-friendly governments in our own neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, at the moment, we have in Bangladesh and in Mali, also in Sri Lanka. I think it is very important for us to strengthen the hands of these governments so that they are able to play constructive roles within their countries and their popularity increases, because they will be able to do what we want done. That is to say, minimize Chinese influence in their respective countries.
Right.
But taking the Chinese head on, which is what the Americans would want us to do, to get drawn into the American axis, into the American alliance systems, that would not be wise for us to do.
Absolutely. You know, Professor, what options then do some of these smaller countries really have at the end of the day? Because they know there is a China right in their backyard, you know, in their foreyard, or whatever you want to call it at the end of the day. So what options do some of these smaller countries have?
Frank, there's an old English saying, money makes the mayor go. Chinese have about 4 to 5 times size of economy compared to India. They have about 12 times foreign exchange reserved compared to India. They have about 4 to 5 times annual bilateral trade compared to India. OBOR expects to, you know, put in $1 trillion into various countries. So we have to be, first of all, pragmatic. And I think a lot of reflection is already happening. that this is an asymmetric relationship. So we are no longer seeking parity with China. But that doesn't mean weak, strong relationship. We have to only change tools, antenna. We have different calibration of how we want to deal with Chinese. So we are emphasizing on how our relations with several of these countries, especially our neighbors, is distinctly, you know, apart from how Chinese are addressing relationship, only commercial relationship. And that is being emphasized in our neighborhood very clearly, and that need to be emphasized. And I think that is showing impact in that sense. But it's also not to say that India is simply playing ball with Beijing. We are doing several things that they are also very upset about. For example, look at India's recent engagements in Sabang in Indonesia. You have Changi in Singapore. We are also investing in places in Sri Lanka. We are, you know, in Assumption Island in Seychelles. We are in Mauritania. We are in Madagascar. We are in Chabahar. Chinese can give you a whole string of pearls which they think they are concerned about. So India is calibrating very carefully and choosing both military options but also diplomatic options. And Chinese, the fact that they have much bigger levers compared to us, they have much bigger leverages and they have one party system, so they can do things at bigger scale and higher speed. And that is already being understood in recalibration of asymmetric relationship that India has. And that is where our equations with other major powers, the European major powers or the United States, becomes very important for us. And I think we have really been building that relationship as well with United States, despite, if you see, Donald Trump's equations with most world leaders are complicated. And you can see India's prime minister as an exception there. So we have carefully managed that relationship so far.
There was a call at the beginning of the year as well where both leaders decided to take forward the bilateral relationship to new heights as well.
Exactly.
Despite what happened with the Afghanistan
but
library issue.
That's a careful walk that India will have to continue doing of not displeasing too far both Beijing and Washington DC, and sort of taking care of not annoying them beyond a point. And I think otherwise basically it is our national interest that guides our policy. And we are carefully making sure we are not seen as aligning with any one of the two sides.
Right.
But the space for neutrality also is decreasing. Remember, the turf is really the trade war and other things are making that neutrality space really limited for India to maneuver. But I think we have to then also emphasize on building our own strong relationship with several of these countries. And some of these efforts are already happening on the ground.
Right.
So basically the report that we are discussing, I think, reinforces the arguments that several Indian people have already been making and several other countries in Asia have been making also as well.
You know, talking about closing comments now from all my guests. Admiral, talking about the United States now, what do you make of the U.S.'s potential missile defense cooperation with India?
You see, it may not happen immediately. It's a slightly long-term plan because the S-400 is just about being inducted. It depends on how many cities that we want to protect. You know, when you have the vital points and vital assets, then you would wish to protect it, which can be targeted by the adversaries. So I think that, you know, it's a good thing that the talk has started, though it may not happen very immediately. But more than that, you know, the trouble with this relationship is that China has overtaken many of these countries in the cyber warfare. And they're doing the cyber reconnaissance at all times. And they feel that they can win a war, an actual battle, or they can collapse the economic systems by interfering in all the systems which are economic systems, financial systems. And that is a matter of big worry to the Americans. And therefore, they have already raised the cyber command. They have increased the strength to about 6,400. Recently, the Defense Intelligence Agency, they came out with a report and they have cautioned the armed forces that please do not have everything on your net, or if it is there, then let it be a standalone. Though even standalone systems can be infected. So the worry of having a S-400 or equivalent system in a major network is another problem. So there has to be some method by which we can have the, Professor Swan Singh said, you know, that asymmetric relationship. We don't have to match everything that the Chinese do, but we have to worry about the China-Pakistan axis.
Right.
And we have to prepare for those vulnerabilities,
sure,
where China is vulnerable, and have your force levels in all aspects, including the domain of space and cyber and electronic warfare, so that you can handle that.
Right. Very quickly, Ambassador, can we expect other like-minded nations really to join the bandwagon, maybe join India and the United States and look towards a more free and open Indo-Pacific?
Well, very frankly, throughout the Cold War, India was able to spearhead the non-aligned movement and kept a lot of countries out of the ambit of the two superpowers. I think we can play a similar role at this time. The Chinese have two very defined, well thought out strategies, the One Belt, One Road Initiative and the Digital Silk Road Initiative, through which they try and increase their economic footprint, particularly in strategically important areas. We should try and sensitize all these countries to the dangers of coming under the Chinese economic footprint. The example of the Maldives is clear. They became so indebted that the per capita debt was in excess of $8,000. Similarly, Sri Lanka became so indebted that it had to give away the Hambantota port for on a 99-year lease to the Chinese. Pakistan is finding itself in a similar debt trap. So what Indian diplomacy can try and achieve is to forewarn through the process of dialogue countries which are tending to fall under Chinese influence of the dangers which they would invite by doing so, and keeping them away from this very unseemly war, this unseemly war of influence which is taking place between the United States on one hand and the Chinese, because the Chinese are trying to displace the United States as the number one power in the Indo-Pacific region. The United States is resenting it, trying to rope in more and more countries to be part of their grand design.
Professor, close the show for us with your concluding remarks on what's the best way forward for India.
I think first it is important to underline that Chinese are no longer, you know, very near to crossing United States. What we are talking of is maybe in, you know, general GDP terms, that they may at some stage be a larger economy than the United States. But United States had several other levers. The simple fact that they are spending 3+ times on defense compared to China. Will China become international leader and take on that kind of responsibility? So I think in one way they could be in becoming a largest economy, but United States will continue to be a very important player for a long time to come. And India understands that, I think, very clearly how to deal with you know, both these countries very, very carefully. And I think it's important to underline that, you know, things like last year you had all 10 ASEAN leaders coming to our Republic Day celebrations. That is a result of India's diplomacy, very clearly, how we are engaging these nations. And, you know, that also has a lot of weight to India when India speaks at global level. And finally, I think there's always an advantage of being not the second in command in that sense, because China is under tremendous scrutiny. Everything China does is being scrutinized, you know, by everybody else in the world. For obvious reasons, India as yet doesn't have that disadvantage. So therefore, you see India, when India procures S-400, United States can definitely not behave the way they behave with the Chinese when Chinese purchase S-400. So we have definite advantages over China. We are largest democracy. We have enormous other advantages of having played a great role in various events last 70 years at global level.
Right.
You know, in that sense, our acceptability at global level is very different compared to Chinese, and that's our strength.
Right.
And I think we must make use of that strength.
Yeah, we should focus on our strengths really going forward, and that's what is going to work to our advantage, is what the panelists are suggesting. With that, it's a wrap on this edition of India's World. I'd like to thank all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. We'd like to hear